Today's featured speaker will talk about service. Please welcome on stage the Director of Global Citizenship and the Head of Film at Dulwich College Shanghai Putong, Mr. Anthony Reich.
It's great to be here on the third day, the final session where we all get together at this IB conference. I'm going to be talking about service and about the importance of service, and I'm really excited because I think it fits in with lots of the workshops and the keynotes that we've already enjoyed this weekend. We are all future educators because we're all going to be back in the classroom tomorrow or Thursday or whenever we get back to our schools. And as future educators, I think it's safe to say that we all dream of a better tomorrow. But dreams are not enough. The question that I want to posit to you this afternoon is, what are we actually going to do about it to bring those dreams to reality? When I see my students at break time, at lunchtime, when they come into my classrooms and I say, hey guys, how are you? What's going on in your lives right now? What are you dealing with? The answer generally revolves around, I got a math test on Friday. I've got an English paper due next week. I've got an IA coming up. I'm like, okay, what else? Well, there's another math test next week, and then there's another paper, and then there's another deadline. Okay, what else? And then, you know, we keep going, and then we'll get to some sports games, or we'll get to a concert, or we'll get to something like that. But first and foremost, it's the deadline. And if that's really what is central to our students' sort of thinking and what's the next thing on their agenda, then I believe we're failing them. Brendan Burchard, a life coach, says it really well when he says we need to be able to ask ourselves three questions. Did I live? Did I love? And did I matter? I can tell you like that question because I just saw a sea of phones raise. And this isn't a question that I'm asking you to think about for yourselves, although you might choose to do that. But I want you to think about this from the perspective of your students. Because if what is on their horizon and if what is dominating their thought is assessments, then can they really say that they matter? That they have a greater purpose? In the fantastic book, Man's Search for Meaning, by Viktor Frankl, he references a study by Johns Hopkins University that studied, that surveyed nearly 8,000 students across 48 colleges over the world. Upon being asked what is most important to you, to your future, only 16% said money. Do you know what 78% said? 78% said having a sense of purpose. Living a life with meaning. That is an overwhelmingly large number. And I believe, and this links in, I mentioned at the beginning, what I'm saying links in with other speakers here. When we go back to what Dr. Jamie Tree said in the first session, she said, in response to questions about well-being, about stress, about depression, the most important factor is what? Having purpose. And I believe that the route to purpose is service. Is serving other people, is using our abilities, our time, our resources to serve others. As you can see, far more intelligent people than me have said this many, many years ago. But I'm not here to say that because Einstein said it, although I think I'd be foolish to disagree with him. I'm here to say it because I've seen it in my own students' lives, in my own life, in the lives of those around me. So how do we transition from wanting to do service? How do we motivate those students that perhaps don't have it in the forefronts of their minds? I think we need to make them angry. I think too many of our students live comfortable lives. I think too many of our students live in expat compounds, in the safer areas of cities. Where do they spend the majority of their days? In walled compounds, schools with gates and fences around them. They're living in safe areas. They don't generally get to experience the poverty that is around all of us. The harsh realities of life, I think it's fair to say, are often protected from our students. But I don't know that that's the right approach. I think there's enough in the world going on right now for us to be angry about and for our students to be angry about, and I don't think there's anything wrong with provoking them and challenging them. If we look at the 17 global goals, they can be boiled down into three main ideals: eradicating extreme poverty, reducing inequality, and protecting the planet. I mean, they're three pretty big topics with about a gazillion subdivisions underneath them, and everybody can get passionate, can get angry about one of those. We just then need to redirect that anger. And yes, we have CAS, and lower down in the IB schools, we have service as action. And yes, when it's done well, it's fantastic. And our students, I'm sure you've all had students who have done fantastic projects in these areas. But do they all? Or do some just treat it as a tick box exercise? So how do we move those students from that apathy towards action and motivation? Well, it starts with us. I can't go to a student and say, I want you, I expect you to give of your time to other people, to serve, to be a good citizen, to do good things, if I'm not doing it myself. Because then all I am is a hypocrite. And no student wants to listen to or follow or agree with a hypocrite. So what I'd like to do is just take a few minutes to share a few strategies, a few ways in which myself and colleagues have been able to try and generate some student initiatives in service, and some hopefully practical tools for you as educators as well. The first thing that service is shared. Service is shared. And there's not a lot that we share in international schools because it's such a competitive market. We want to be the best. We want to have the best grades. We want to have the best sports teams. We want to have the best facilities. We want to have the best students. We want to have the best, the best, the best, the best, the best. Why? Because we want students to come to our school, not the school down the road. And we seem to be caught up in this cycle of, yeah, well, you should come to our school because we're pretty good. Do you know the root of the word competition? The etymology of the word competition is competere from Latin. And do you know what that means? It means to strive together. It doesn't mean to beat, to defeat, to be better than. It means to strive together. And I think that with service in particular, we need to be coming together. We need to be sharing resources and saying to these competitors across the road, hey, this is what I tried. It didn't work. Do you have any ideas? Or, hey, this is something that we tried and it kind of worked out okay. Are you struggling with something similar? And as a way of trying to deal with this, a friend of mine at a local school, Concordia, which is just around the corner from Dulwich where I work, and I got together recently and really felt compelled to do something in this area. So we set up the Shanghai Service and Sustainability Network. We had our first meeting a month ago. We had 15 schools take part with over 50 educators, some of whom I know are here today. It was just a start. But it was a great start, and we're looking forward to building on that and having a repository of people who are passionate and ideas where we can come together and share those so that we're not in competition with each other, because there's no point in being in competition when it comes to service and it comes to trying to do good things in the world. We're not competing against anybody but ourselves. The next thing that service is service is embedded. And there's been some fantastic workshops on this at this conference already. And to link on from what I was saying about shared, I went to one yesterday by the Canadian International School of Hong Kong, who were so generous with their resources. Anybody that came, here you are, have our resources. That's what I'm talking about. But it's embedded. I'm not going to go into the details of learning that is connected to our heart and our emotional intelligence is far deeper than our cognitive learning alone, because far better speakers have gone into far more detail and research than me than that. But suffice to say that if we can embed services action into our curriculum, it's going to be a lot more profound for everybody. Service is reflective. Before I tell you a little bit about this slide that for me captures like 1,000 words, I just need to give you a little bit of context. A few years ago at my school, we had an international speaker come along, and he basically fired us up and said, guys, you're the privileged 1%, what are you doing about it? I guess in a way slightly similar to what I'm saying now. And myself and a couple of other teachers, good friends, came out and said, yeah, that's absolutely right, what are we doing about it? And through that, and I mean, this is a ridiculously long story, but I'll try and say it in about 20 seconds. We worked with our school, with Dulwich, and we established a project in Uganda, a children's home. And for the last 6 years, we've been taking students there every summer and working very much in partnership with the Peace Center, which is essentially the home to 40 AIDS orphans. So each year, we take a group of students out there. And each year, we build in intentional, dedicated, specific time for reflection. And we go outside of the children's home so that we can really take time and find peace to reflect. And here we are in Lake Bunyoni down in southwest Uganda, a beautiful spot. And we had a few discussions and gave the students a few prompter questions. And then we said to them, okay, some free writing time. We'd just like you to really reflect on the first week that we've had here in the village and just sort of pour out some thoughts onto the page. That's what they're doing right here. You can see them with their journals. We came back together about 40 minutes later, just as the sun was beginning to set. And one of these girls said, can I share something? Sure. She goes, I wrote a letter to my mum and dad. Okay, would you like to share it with us? I think I would, yes please. And she said, she wrote, dear mum and dad, I am so sorry. I am so sorry. I come home from school and you try and give me a hug and ask me how my day was, and I ignore you and go to my room and I shut the door. You cook me meals, and I don't express any gratitude. You do everything for me, and what do I give you in return but a cold shoulder? This week, Mum and Dad, I witnessed poverty like I've never seen it before. I met a little girl, a beautiful little girl, whose mother had died of AIDS 3 years previously and whose father was on the deathbed. We'd heard 2 days later that her father died, and this five-year-old girl was left with no one and nothing. Mum and Dad, this girl needs love and a home, and I've got both of those, and I'm throwing it away. And she was reading out this letter, and tears were streaming down her face. We've got to make sure that whenever we do service, we embed time for reflection. Because if the service is being done well, these students are going to be profoundly impacted and they need a space to unpack that. Service is about verifying needs. It's not about thinking that we know everything and we go into a community and we're the experts and we can do everything because we're coming from a position of affluence and knowledge. We need to be in partnership with host communities. I had a student that came to me recently and said, I want to run a basketball program with the migrant school around the corner who we already do a swimming and a music and a language program with. I said, okay, great. Why do you want to do that? I love basketball. I'm like, okay, that's really good. Do they love basketball? That's a good question, sir. Yeah. Let's see if we can find out an answer to that before we go charging in and offering programs that aren't needed. We need to be verifying needs. And here's an example of a project that does verify needs. And this is a project that I think is fantastic and truly transformative. Again, this is linked into our annual trip to the Peace Center. And we had a group of students go, this was last year, and they emailed the directors, two girls emailed the directors a few months in advance and said, hey guys, we're really looking forward to seeing you again. What do you need? And they said, we need sanitary pads. Can you bring out sanitary pads for us? So the girls came back and we had a meeting and said, okay, do we want to take, there's 20 girls living in the Peace Center, do we want to take a year's worth of supplies for 20 girls' sanitary pads? That doesn't seem like the most productive use of resources. And when we found out that they were just going to burn the used ones and incinerate them, we were really questioning the sustainability of this. So these two girls started doing some investigating. They did some research. They found a fantastic organization called Days for Girls, who have a base in Uganda, as well as many around the world. And Days for Girls makes sustainable sanitary pads that are used for 3 years. They're cleaned in between and used for about 3 years. So our students thought, hey, we're going to Uganda, there's an office in Uganda, maybe we can hook up. So they emailed the directors of Days for Girls. They arranged a meeting, we went along, we bought 20 sets of pads for these girls, and they went and gifted them when we went down there. And these girls were really excited about this because they could see the difference that it was going to make in these kids' lives, because so many children in sub-Saharan Africa miss school during their periods. These girls won't miss school anymore. But they weren't satisfied with just trying to do what they could for those 20. So they thought, okay, how can we expand this project to more people? Because did you know that 88% of women around the world do not have access to menstrual health products? 88% of women. 88% of women use sand, leaves, feathers, rags, even dung. Even dung. You know what this did to those two girls when they found out this? Do you know what it made them? It made them angry. And they thought, we need to do something about this. So they put together this fantastic program where they run workshops, simulating, making, getting students to make their own sanitary pads. They got some sewing machines and they started to make them. And they got their friends involved, boys as well as girls, and they're making these pads. Why? Because they verified the need beforehand, they saw what the need was, and they acted on it. And in doing that, they were engaging their interests, skills, and talents. The next part of service, which I like to think speaks for itself, and I haven't got time to go into anyway. Service is also changing the lens. This is a photograph that I really like. Might be paternal bias. This is my daughter at her Service Superheroes Club that she does on a Tuesday afternoon. She came home that day beaming. I mean, you can see it. That was her there. And she came home and said, Daddy, we're going to change the world. We're going to change the world. Because we've got to look at the world through the lens. We've got to change how we look at the world, and we can't look at the world about being about me anymore, Daddy. We've got to look at the world and think about other people. We've got to put on our global gold glasses, and we've got to change how we see the world. Finally, service is empathic. It's not about charity. We ban the C word in my school. Because charity implies I'm better than you. It implies benevolence. It's not an equal relationship. And service needs to be about mutually beneficial learning, about cultural exchange, about working together. It's not about handouts. Empathy is really important in that. Walking a mile in another man's shoes and you understand his journey. That's what service is in a nutshell. We don't have to be doing big things. We can do small things. And before I wrap up, I just want to watch a 90-second video by Nobel laureate Wangari Maathai, who explains this beautifully.
We are constantly being bombarded by problems that we face, and sometimes we can get completely overwhelmed. The story of the hummingbird is about this huge forest being consumed by a fire. All the animals in the forest come out and they are transfixed as they watch the forest burning, and they feel very overwhelmed, very powerless. Except this little hummingbird. It says, I'm going to do something about the fire. So it flies to the nearest stream, takes a drop of water, and puts it on the fire, and goes up and down, up and down, up and down, as fast as it can. In the meantime, all the other animals, much bigger animals, like the elephant with a big trunk, could bring much more water. They are standing there helpless, and they are saying to the hummingbird, what do you think you can do? You're too little. This fire is too big. Your wings are too little. And your beak so small, you can only bring a small drop of water at a time. But as they continue to discourage it, it turns to them without wasting any time and tells them, I am doing the best I can. And that to me is what all of us should do. We should always feel like a hummingbird. I may feel insignificant, but I certainly don't want to be like the animals watching as the planet goes down the drain. I will be a hummingbird. I will do the best I can.
I will be a hummingbird. I will do the best I can. And I believe if we can say that, and we can instill that message into our students, we will see that they are living, that they are loving, and that their lives matter. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Anthony.